Okay, we start in a minute. Can we close the door so for the noise that will be better? Thank you very much. Okay, thank you. So, we're here to talk about network virtualization and how I will say sometimes NYSERA, my bad. I'm Dimitri Desmit. I'm a technical marketing engineer. And I work for the NSBU, so the Network and Security Business Unit within VMware. And I come from NYSERA. And sometimes I still say NYSERA, my bad. So we're here to talk about the NVP plugin, the NSX plugin, within OpenStack. But just before that, we'll start with a quick introduction on what VMware does in this overall OpenStack.
Good afternoon, folks. Can I get the mic on? Hello? Okay. Good afternoon, folks. I'm Samik Behera. I'm a product manager in VMware's Network and Security Business Unit. I was, as I was saying in the previous panel, where some of you were already here, I was one of the founding members of the OpenStack Neutron, or otherwise known as Quantum Project. And I've been familiar with this space for a while. And I wanted to just give a preview of our VMware's philosophy with OpenStack before Dimitri dives deep and gets into detail and does all the work with this, and you know, to make sure that you guys understand everything. So what do you think about OpenStack as VMware? Our belief is that OpenStack enables customer choice. It's an open framework. It's a framework. It doesn't come with, it's not a product. So you still need an hypervisor, right? You still need storage. You still need SAN. You still need networking. And VMware sells the best of breed solutions in each of those infrastructure space. So it made just the logical choice for our customers and for us to make sure our product portfolio of software-defined data center solutions is very well integrated into OpenStack. We actually feel it's a net new market opportunity for us, and it's an accelerator for our customer who are trying to adopt OpenStack and bring it to their environments. So that's what we feel. And in order to do that, peeling the onion a little bit, what it means is that the components over there in blue are VMware components, whole VMware Blue. So as a customer, now you have choice to take our VM integrations with each one of these OpenStack components and use all VMware Blue entire stack, or pick and choose what you want, right? At the end of the day, it's about customer choice and how you want to build your own cloud. And we believe that you should have the choice. And for that, we introduced this release plugins for Nova, you know, NSX for Neutron. We have vSAN and other storage technologies for Cinder and Glance, as well as operations tools, which we hear from customers are a big hurdle to taking OpenStack into production. We have plugins for vCenter operations, provides predictive alerts and management, log insight. It's about log analytics and so that you can debug these logs. And we believe this essentially means that you know you get best of both worlds, essentially, right? OpenStack has this great framework, it's an open API, it's a great vibrant ecosystem, provides choice, and VMware has the best in class virtualization and the core engines that power the world's largest and most reliable and robust cloud environments. With that, I will let Dimitri take over. Take it away, Dimitri.
Thank you. So let's focus now on what VMware does in the network piece, okay? So if you, as you know, inside OpenStack, you have actually multiple projects, and I'll focus on the network component, which is called Neutron. And you may have heard, or you may remember, the old name Quantum. So it has been renamed, that's the same thing. So I'll focus on what VMware does on that block. Okay, just one quick word. Actually, in the previous session, people talked about Nova Network. That was the first option you had within OpenStack to provide network as a service. And it's still available today. The last session talked about the limitations and why it's cool. And you have many benefits to use Neutron instead of Nova Network. So some limited network topologies, I won't even mention them. You'll have the slides. You can look at that. But limited network of topologies, so you can host on your cloud with Nova Network just a subset of what your applications are. The big, big one is you don't support with Nova Network three-tier architectures with, you know, a front-end web tier, a middle app tier, and a back-end database. It's not supported with Nova Network. You don't have a rich number of network services, such as you don't have load balancers, no VPN, and doesn't scale very high. We can talk about that offline if you want. No integration with third party to overcome those limitations. And this one is not a big red X, because you have some HA and some management tools, but very limited and rudimentary. So anyway, that was the past. In OpenStack, you have Neutron that enhance, or that, yeah, enhance Nova Network, and you can do more than that. So we talked about briefly about the three-tier architecture. It's something you can host now in your, within your OpenStack. There are more network services as well. In security, you can protect or make rules to limit the traffic from outside to inside, and you can make rules to protect also traffic from inside to the outside world, where with Nova Network, it's only from outside to inside. You have load balancer as a service. You have coming VPN as a service, so richer network services with Neutron. There is also the ability to create an overlay. So when you create a three-tier architecture, like here, and you have that for multiple tenants, instead of using and consuming a VLAN for each subnet on your physical fabric, then you can create an overlay, and when a VM, let's say VM Orange, talks from 10.10.10 to 10.10.10.11, they talk together, they are in the same subnet, but on two different hypervisors, the physical fabric will not see the IP, will not see the MAC address of the VMs, but we'll see the IP of the hypervisor one talking to the hypervisor two. So more subnets you create, more network topologies you create, you don't touch the fabric. So that's pretty nice. And within Neutron, the encapsulation done is GRE. OK, now also, if there is any other limitation or things you want to do that is not available via Neutron, then there is the ability within Neutron to expand your capabilities adding plugins. Some of them are open source. OVS plugin is a popular one. Some of them are vendor-based. And on the top of the list, you can see our plugin, the VMware NSX plugin, which was known as the NYSERA MVP plugin in the past. You may have heard about that. So that's the same thing. It has just been renamed. But some other vendors, Cisco plugin is there. Somebody talked in the last session about some changes done with Big Switch. They have a plugin as well, NEC. So different plugin. It's an open solution. So let's talk about why people will use Neutron with our plugin. Okay, why people do that? So people do that for multiple reasons. Our plugin is really well known for scale, so of course I will talk about that. But not only, that's not the only reason why people are using our plugin. So scale, let's go briefly around that. First, on the size of your cloud. So you can have really a very large, massive cloud. We support, as of today, and it's enhanced in each release, and we do a release every 3 months, up to 60,000 instances, so up to 60,000 VMs with 15,000 different tenants and hosted on different 1,000 different hypervisors. And that's actually per NSX domain, so you can have multiple of NSX domains to go even higher today. And as I said, those numbers go up in each release. And what, I mean, how do we achieve that? It's thanks to a controller cluster. So the brain of this is done by the NSX controller, and it's a fully distributed system that helps us to go very high. Then there is, okay, the size of your cloud, but there is also how much you can push out of each hypervisor, because the VMs need to talk to other VMs within your cloud. So we use encapsulation as well. I talked about encapsulation available within Neutron. We do offer also encapsulation. We don't use this GRE encapsulation. We use another type of encapsulation called STT. It's open sourced. And this has a big, I mean, is doing encapsulation like GRE, but the big difference is it's not using the CPU of the hypervisor to encapsulate the traffic, but it's using the NIC capabilities to encapsulate the traffic. So when the traffic goes out, we don't consume CPU of the host, of the hypervisor. So the CPU remains available for the VM compute, which is what it's designed for, the hypervisor. So we can saturate a 210 gig NIC bounded, so 20 gig out of each hypervisor. And then your cloud may need to talk to the external world. I mean, VMs, your web VMs will talk to the app VMs and do their application stuff, but people will access the VMs, or the VMs will download some patches or stuff from internet. So you have north-south communication. And this goes out via what we call NSX gateways, and those are also in a cluster active-active, so we can do more than 10 gig out of each, and if you need more, you just add nodes in your gateway cluster, okay, for massive scale. And those gateways can offer L3 communication to the outside world, to the physical world, or L2 communication as well. I'll talk about that in a moment. So you can have a VM in one subnet talking to a physical server, not in your cloud, anywhere in the world, a physical server, and have L2 adjacency between the two. Okay. So I'll finish on that bullet for the scale section. Optimize traffic. What do I mean by that? I'll give an example. What you have out of OpenStack is you can do, as I said, with Neutron, not Nova Network, but with Neutron out of the box, if I may say, a topology like that. And if the database tier wants to talk to a VM in the app network, the traffic will go to its default gateway, which is hosted on the Neutron server, and will go to the VM app. So in the physical world, it will go from this hypervisor to the Neutron server, back to hypervisor one, where you have the app VM. Make sense? If the web VM talks to the app VM, in the physical world, go to Neutron's, back to hypervisor one. And you can easily see that Neutron server, where you have all the different logical routers for all the different tenants, may easily become a choke point when you have lots of east-west traffic, or lots of L3 traffic, because everything will go through that box, through that server. With NSX, we have the concept of logical router distributed. So when you remain within your cloud, so let's use the same two examples. The database talks to the app server, and the database is on hypervisor 2, the app server is on hypervisor 1, it will go to its logical router, which is here, on hypervisor 2, and go straight to hypervisor 1, and doesn't go through our NSX gateway. This one will be used only for one use case, and I'll talk about that in 1 minute. But not that use case, because I stay inside. The web VM goes to the app VM, and let's say they're on the same hypervisor. This logical router orange, tenant B, is also here, and it actually doesn't leave hypervisor 1. The real fabric network will not see that L3 traffic. It remains within hypervisor 1. So when do you go through our NSX gateways that scale massively, as I said, because you can have them in a cluster? They are actually not used for inside traffic within your cloud. That's used for the outgoing traffic. When those VMs want to go to internet, to download some patches or whatever, then that will use our NSX gateway, only north-south. Okay, so we talked about scale. Some people enjoy NSX for also our ease of use to provide HA and management monitoring. So HA, for the control space, As I said before, it's offered by NSX controller clusters. They work in an active-active fashion. That's why we scale so high in terms of size of your cloud. And they work in a distributed mode. But if one of them dies, automatically the remaining nodes are aware, thanks to health check, are aware of this node dead and will redistribute the load among the remaining ones. There is no interruption in your cloud activities when one node dies. Same thing for the transport, for the VM traffic. Not the control, but for the VM traffic, for the production traffic. So as you remember, the communication from inside to outside is done via gateways, NSX gateways. They work in a cluster for massive scale. Also, same concept. If one dies, the remaining nodes will take care of the task of that one. And it's done in a very fast manner. Actually, we'll do that in a demo. So it's not like you will need to restart a new node and wait for that node to join and get the traffic and lose production for many, many seconds or even minutes, okay? So management is also something that is enhanced with our plugin. So it's cool to have a cloud running, but I mean, one day you may have a customer that calls you and say, hey, my VM cannot talk to my VM, and you have to troubleshoot and understand why. So we have many, many tools that are useful to use OpenStack in production, and not only in a lab, a science lab. So, I mean, statistics, okay, in, out, bytes, packets, but some other stuff, like this one is very popular. Port connection. When you have a cloud, you may lose where are stuff because you deployed, actually you did not deploy, your tenants self-deployed their infrastructure within your cloud. And you don't know where stuff is, so when you receive a call and, okay, my VM cannot talk to my VM, this tool will quickly tell you for that tenant on port 2 to port 7, those two VMs are for this one on KVM1, for this one, it's on ESXi3, and you know where physically they are. And then you know when they talk, the communication on the physical network, is not the IP address of the VMs, it's the IP of KVM1 talking to the IP of ESXi3, because the traffic is encapsulated. And we actually check every 300 milliseconds, you don't have to remember that number, if the tunnel is alive and working fine. So you can see it's working fine and the communication, those two VMs should talk. Now, let's say it's still not working. So we have some other tools, like you can ask, or you can generate a ping from that VM to validate the traffic is going through the physical network and through the two hypervisors. And you can do that without you asking the customer to give you root access of his VM or asking the customer to do anything. You can generate yourself traffic. And this traffic will really go through your fabric, your network to the other hypervisor and get a green or red flag. You can generate more than ping yourself, not the tenant. Yourself can generate a specific packet to validate it's well received to the other side. You can, I don't know if you're a network guy, but if you're a network guy, you played with those physical boxes and you know how to do ER span to send traffic out of a port on a physical switch to your PC where you have Wireshark and you can see stuff. You can do that, but now from the logical world. So you can say this VM logical switch port, send all the traffic received and sent from that port to my PC, and I analyze that. If the VM moves, because you have some hypervisors that does support vMotion or does some dynamic placement of VMs, like vCenter, then this configuration remains, because the logical switch port remains the same. So the port mirroring will still work, and you will still receive the traffic from that VM, even if the VM moves. And I don't know how long you've played with OpenStack, but if you've played on OpenStack for a few releases, you know what it is to upgrade OpenStack. The challenges it could be. To upgrade our solution, it's actually a very simple process because built in, we have the ability to upgrade the NSX solution through a nice automated UI. And if you remember, each element is clusterized. So this will upgrade a node at a time, so you can upgrade your entire NSX cloud without interruption, doing it smartly, automatically, one at a time. Okay. So we talked about scale, but we talked also about other points we are not as well known, HA and monitoring. Some other things, and I'll finish with that. We offer also some network services you don't have out of Neutron. Static routing, so you know what it is, so I won't spend too much time, but you can create, or the tenant can create himself a default gateway and a route to go somewhere else for a specific subnet, or black hole, you cannot go to that subnet. Okay. I briefly talked about that. We do support L3 from logical to physical. We support L2 from logical to physical. So you can have a physical server in a data center somewhere in an IP address 10.10.10.10 and a VM in your cloud 10.10.10.5 and they have L2 communication. Okay, through an NSX gateway. We can explain that. I can explain that if you want later, how it works in the bit and byte. But we do offer that with some service providers, actually one in Asia, offering that to his customers. ACL, access control list, you know what it is, so I won't explain that. But that can be combined with security profile. So that gives you more flexibility and more use cases you can host. Actually, you should be able to host any kind of application your customers have within your OpenStack cloud with the NSX plugin. QoS in two flavors, guaranteed traffic for a VM, max traffic for a VM, so that's within your cloud. And QoS also on the fabric. So if there is any congestion in your cloud on the physical fabric because there is too much traffic going on, we can tag the traffic. So the physical network will differentiate traffic from orange to blue, from tenant orange, from between orange and blue tenants, using DSCP. OK, and we have also, I'll finish with that before doing the demo, optimization of broadcast and multicast. So if you have a cloud and with multiple hypervisors and a VM send a broadcast, you don't want that broadcast to go everywhere because the, let's say, the tenant the VM blue, light blue, sends a broadcast. There is no point of sending that broadcast to hypervisor one. Hypervisor one doesn't have a VM light blue in that same subnet, in that same network. So again, our controller cluster is smart enough to know that and will tell the hypervisors to send it only to hypervisor two and not one. So we distribute broadcast and unique and multicast in a fast and optimized manner because it doesn't go everywhere. Okay. So I think that was roughly 20 minutes. Now the demo and then the Q&A. So I have multiple demos. I'll try to go fast and we can go deeper if you want at the end of the session. The first one I want to show you is what I talked about, a multi-tier application. Okay, hosted in your cloud on OpenStack Havana with a VM web in the app in the web tier, two VMs in the app tier, and L3 communication to the physical world, L3 communication within your cloud, and L2 communication to a remote physical server somewhere else over there. So that's what I will do in demo one. In demo two, I'll show vMotion, because actually, some VMs are on KVM, some VMs are on ESXi. I'll show vMotion and show that it's still working. Some management and monitoring tool, and I'll do a failure of our cluster gateways to see that everything is still working fine for the tenants. And I'll show you very quickly that everything does not change. You still use your OpenStack, Havana dashboard, Horizon, or any dashboard you have, because that's actually the same API call. OK, so let's jump to it. It's already 55, yeah. So That's your, let's sign out because I guess I timed out. Okay. So I go to my OpenStack. I go to tenant A. And you can see that I have the two networks, web and app tier, and my logical router that routes between the two and to internet. So you can see the VMs here. Some are on ESXi, some are on KVM. Let's go to a KVM quick. On the ESXi, On the ESXi, I'll show you where it is. It's on my vCenter here. Okay, you can see if config. Okay, 10.024. 10.024, you can see this one, 10.025. Okay. Actually, if config, you can already see it. 10.025, they can, I mean, that's a ping. I know it's not that impressive, but you can see they have communications L2 within your cloud. You can see they can ping their default gateway. Okay, this one is actually local on the hypervisor because it's distributed. If he wants to talk to another, which one is it? 1.5. The routing within your cloud works fine. I mean, for the tenant, it doesn't know anything, but it's distributed, so that's pretty nice, and can go to the physical world via L3 out of your cloud. I think it's this one. Here we go. So I've been able to quickly demonstrate L2 communication within the cloud, L3 communication within your cloud, and L3 communication to the outside world. And let's show you quickly L2 communication to the physical world. That will be a ping, not as impressive as well. But just to show you that L2 communication talks to the physical world. Here we go. There is one here. Perfect. Now, let's go to the demo number two quick. So let's do a vMotion, and let's see if something broke. So I'll ping something in the physical world, 10, 100, 1, 211. Here we go. And I'll migrate the VM. I don't know where the VM here is now. The VM is on 122. I'll move it quick to 121. Okay. So the migration is in progress. The ping is still running. And oops. I lost communication to my VM. That's nice. It's not what should have happened. Here we go. The ping was still running. And you can see that I lost two pings, 37 received, 39 sent, 37 received. That's the two seconds that took my vMotion to happen. And so that has been transparent. You haven't touched anything. So if you have a hypervisor that does dynamic placement of VMs to place VMs in a smart way, in a dynamic way, then you can still use that and nothing changed in your network virtualization side. Now, let's do some troubleshooting and monitoring tools we have out of the box. So if someone calls you, hey, my VM app 1 cannot talk to my VM app 2, the case I gave before, let's look at that. Oops, that's not where I wanted to go. My screen is too small. Sorry for that. So I select, it's really too small. Switch names. So your customer calls you and you say, okay, I'm tenant A and my two VMs on the network 2 don't talk together. So fine, you select the two VMs of tenant A network 2. And hopefully you have a bigger screen so you don't have to go up and down. You click on port connection, and automatically in real time, NSX will tell you for that switch, for those two VMs, 3 and 4, they look all good, and they are, for the first one on ESXi1, for the second one on KVM1, that shows you actually mix of hypervisors is fine. And the communication is working fine between those two hypervisors. If they want to go out to internet via L3, they go through that cluster of gateways, and everything looks cool. You can do a ping and validate without asking the tenant. They can really reach each other with a ping. Or what you can also do is go directly here, and you can create your own packet. If they say, oh, they can ping, but they cannot do XYZ communication, you have the trace flow and inject yourself the traffic to validate it's working fine without asking the customer to do it and or route access to his VM. So pretty neat. And if I redo the vMotion, you will see that automatically, I wait for the vMotion to finish. Here we go. You will see that if I click go again, it did update the information about on what ESXi it is. So now it should be ESXi2. And told KVM about now use your tunnel to ESXi2. And you've seen before you lost only two pings. That has nothing to do with this. But to the fact that during the vMotion, you lose two pings for the VM to move between hypervisors. OK, so I'll finish with one thing, the HA. So today I'm using, remote can be on a small screen can be challenging. OK, I do my ping. I kill my gateway. One of my two gateways, they're actually VMs. Okay, and you'll see that the ping is still working fine and running, and there was no interruption. Okay? Actually, if I cancel the ping, you'll see you lost four packets. So it was not minutes or weeks of getting back your cloud up to speed when the node dies. It's a matter of second, okay? And that will be always between 3 and 4 seconds when you have a failure. I think we've done through all the demos. I'll just show you how easy it is. It's just using the same tool. What I'll do is on that tenant, I have only one tier. I'm tenant B, and I have one VM on one subnet, a router that routes the two, and let's say I want to create myself as a tenant, another subnet, and create a multi-tier architecture. I create a new network. Okay, forget about the names. We're running late. 10.040/24. Create. Here we go. I created my subnet. Now I will add an interface on my router to go to that subnet, add interface, QQQ. Here we go. I created a multi-tier application. Let's create a VM on that one. And I'll call it VM2, this flavor. And I have a bunch of images from KVM and ESXi, but let's use ESXi for fun. The other one already existing is from KVM. Oop, it will complain I did not select a network. Here we go. And voila, my VM is coming. And if we look at ESX, vCenter, let's go to the vCenter. My VM is coming. You see, C77 has just been created and will start in a second. So for the tenant, nothing changed. You can just create rich network from the UI nodes. For the cloud architect, it's just the same API call, so it doesn't have to do any change in what he built. Okay, here we go. My VM is up and running and ready to use. that's the end of the demo. We can open the Q&A session. Waiting for that, I'll just put some customer names we have in the service provider space and enterprise space. OK, you'll help. Yeah.
Sure, I can take that. So ML2 is just an architecture from Neutron perspective, how to make things modular, right? So NSX plugin, when ML2 is not fully production ready, it was just introduced. So we support ML2, and we have the NSX plugin in the ML2 form factor, as well as the traditional monolithic form factor. And when the community adopts ML2, it will be fully operational with ML2. Sure. I mean, it's a fully extensible platform. So if you have a VM which does some services, you can still build on top of the virtual networks provided by NSX, as well as NSX allows networking vendors even to partner directly within the platform at the data plane level, which is a richer integration than compared to Neutron, which is kind of like a management plane integration. So from ML2, you can do a management plane only integration or a deep integration, depending on the partnership, the customers that exist.
Yeah.
Take this one.
Yeah, so there are multiple kind of encapsulation available. We talked about GRE offered by Neutron. We talked about STT we do out of NSX. Actually, within NSX, we support multiple kind of encapsulations. You can still use GRE. Your performance will be much worse, and I don't know why you will do that, but we do support that. Now, about VXLAN. I mean, you could use VXLAN out of, or you can use actually now VXLAN out of NSX, and I'm fine with that. That said, 100 of our customers still use STT. Why? Because of the performance. The day the NIC cards will support encapsulation on the NIC and not on the CPU of the hypervisor, then I don't see why people will still use STT. And it's coming. There are only two vendors of NICs in the world, and everything else is OEM. And they are both of them working on doing encapsulation on the NIC. Now, just one thing, NSX, the value or the strength of NSX is not because we use STT, which actually we open sourced. It's because of the intelligence of the controller to push all the information to the edge, to the hypervisors, to tell them what to do, where to go, the distributed router, and all the stuff I mentioned. The STT is just one small element of all the benefits you have out of NSX. Does that reply to your question? There was another one in the back.
So when you did the demo with the NSX controller going down?
Oh, you want me to kill a controller?
No. When you kill the controller there,
gateway.
You
did
a payload.
Gateway.
Oh, the gateway.
Was it the gateway which you killed?
Yeah, I killed the gateway. So when you go to the physical world, it's done through a gateway. We are actually working with partners, vendors, network vendors, to use directly the physical switch, but let's keep that on the side. So when you go out, you go through a gateway, and they work in an active-active fashion, as I said, because you have multiple tenants, OK? So let's say you have 100 tenants and four nodes on your gateway cluster. Each gateway will be in charge of some tenants for the north-south. And another one will be standby for that one. Something unique I did not highlight much, the sessions are synced. So if you have some NAT going from inside to outside or outside to inside, and there is a failover, the new active box for those tenants will still work, and their NAT sessions will still work. Nothing is lost. Now, there is a failover time for the standby to detect the active is dead. And this is not done by the controller. This is done by the gateways themselves, because they talk to each other. And that failover time is what? Between 3 to 4 seconds. And that's why you've seen three or four pings lost.
Okay.
Okay.
And the key thing about that is that it's a network level HA. It's a network level failover. That's how networks are used to. It's not kind of like Nova Network or Quantum Network node. It's not a server level HA where you have like something which actually uses Linux HA and brings up another server. So it doesn't have to detect at that level. The time it takes is longer when it's server HA versus a network HA.
So we're talking about a couple of seconds instead of minutes of HA. And the NAT sessions are not lost. So if you have an SSH, an FTP, an HTTP, or whatever, still works. The logical, you take this one?
Sure. Yeah, that's definitely possible. I mean, you can bridge to the external world at the L2, and then external world router can take over. Or you can have the external router point to the logical router within the NSX domain, and it connects at L3, and it talks uses external router.
Obviously, you're not using HSRP, any standards for
the
protocol between your
router. No. Yeah. But we're in the logical world also. So, I mean, HSRP, it's when you have two physical boxes. Our logical router is where? A little bit everywhere. You know, we have the distributed router, so it just doesn't make sense.
Cool.
Okay.
We're running out of time.
So, I think.
Any questions?
I think we're running out of time. But yeah, if you have any question, we'll be next to the door for the next 15 minutes. Thank you very much.
Thanks, everybody.